Congugate students, welcome to the third part of my video on section 2.3. We're going to work with limits and continue that. That was a little bit of the song Sweet Georgia Brown. I remember as a kid, the Harlem Globetrotters basketball team. That was the theme song from their show. Got up early morning, Saturday morning cartoons and stuff. You could always catch the Harlem Globetrotters. All right, so going through limits, what we're going to begin to look at a little bit on this is, let's start with this example. We're going to look at some different techniques. To begin with on this, let's just plug in the 1 and see what we get. So you would have 1 to the second minus 1 over 1 minus 1. So you would get 0 over 0. Now this is what we call an indeterminate form. And any time that your limit starts off as 0 over 0, well, the limit will exist, typically. But in order to figure out the value of the limit without graphing, you usually require some basic algebra. So we're going to kind of get a lot into the algebra as we work these out then. So that's always a good place to start. Plug the number in, see what happens. 0 over 0. Step 2, start thinking about algebra. So if you look at this, this will factor, so we're going to factor that. Now be sure when you're writing your steps out, you know, just make it like a nice presentation. So like, go ahead and factor that, bring down your limit. So that will factor as x plus 1 times x minus 1. You want to review your factoring a lot in this class. That's a difference of two squares. Okay, so you want to do that. Look what happens. This cancels out. Okay, because that's really just 1. Anything divided by itself is 1. Well, let's write down what we're left with. We still have the limit, so we have the limit as x goes to 1 of x plus 1. Now we just plug in and we'll get an answer. So now we get 1 plus 1, so that's equal to 2. All right, so the answer to that limit is actually 2. Well, let's look at graphically what's going on this problem, because this will always help you understand conceptually what's going on in the problem. All right. So I'm going to go ahead and put this in your calculator. You can put this in your calculator. I'd recommend you do that along with me. So we're going to go parentheses x to the second minus 1, close parentheses, and then divide by x minus 1. Be sure the numerator and denominator are in a set of parentheses. Right, so then what we're going to do is we're going to just graph that in a standard window. Okay, so I'm just going to go zoom 6, standard window. So it looks like we have a line, and actually we do have a line. There's one piece of this, though, that's missing. So what's happening on this problem is really this. Okay, we were left over with a x plus 1. So if you think about graphing y equals x plus 1 without your calculator, well, you would have this. You'd have a y-intercept of 1, and then you would have a slope of 1. So that slope is the number in front of x, so 1 over 1 is your slope. So remember, a slope's a rise over 1, so you just go up 1 over 1, up 1 over 1, and so forth, and that would be your line. You could also go down 1, left 1, and then that's your line. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and just connect that into a straight line. Man, look at that. Ooh, that's perfect. Okay, now here's one thing it's missing. Okay, if you go back to the original problem, this is undefined at x equals 1. Okay, so x cannot be 1, because if it is, what do you get? You get a 0 denominator. So what happens when x is 1 is you have a bubble here. So what you want to do is a little bubble right there. Okay, right there. When x is 1, that's where that bubble is going to be, like that. Graphing calculator does not show that, but notice if I trace at 2, again, trace 2, look what happens. Well, we get, not trace 2, trace 1, sorry. So if I trace at 1, what happens is it's undefined. That's why it gives y equals space. Another thing you can do is go second graph, open the table of values, and well, you can see you're undefined at x equals 1. But what happens on this problem then, clearly from what we learned, is if you take a number barely bigger than 1, like if you take trace 1.1, well, you can see that number's getting close to 2. right? And if you traced a number like 1.9, then you're getting a number close, whoops, not 1.9, 0.9, a number that's less than 1. So it goes like that. So the left-hand limit goes to 2, so does the right-hand limit. And that's kind of what we've been talking about. I could close in further and further, getting closer and closer to, I'm still screwing up here, 0.9, I got to be close to 1, okay? Then if I go 0.99, well, I get closer and closer still. If I put a whole bunch of 9s in there, I just get closer to 2. So that's kind of what we have learned previously anyway. Okay, so that's kind of how you handle that. The graphing is not really necessary in this problem. You can just do this totally algebraically, but the graphing calculator will certainly help open up to you what this looks like then. Okay, so let's move to this next example here. And with this one, we're going to start off exactly the same way. We're just going to plug in the number that I gave you, so plug the 2 in, so you'd have 3 times 2 to the second minus 7 times 2 plus 2 all over 2 minus 2. Okay, if you work that out, that looks like 4 times 3 is 12 minus 14 plus 2 over 0. So again, you get 0 over 0. I put the quotation marks around that because this is a form. Okay, you don't work out 0 over 0. 0 over 0 is undefined, but in terms of calculus and limits, we call that an indeterminate form. So, like the last problem, what we want to do is we want to think about algebra, and it looks like this is a trinomial that'll factor. And I'm going to go ahead and do this at the side. Sometimes students struggle a little bit with factoring. I'm going to show you just kind of how I like to do this. So the first term is this term. So if you draw two parentheses, the only possible numbers that multiply to give that first term are 3t and t. So I have 3t here, t here. Okay, then the last term is the 2. And then what you do is you just look at numbers that multiply to give 2. Well, we could go 2 and 1. Let's go ahead and try 2 and 1 like that, 2 times 1. Now, this part right here, I kind of call this the clincher. Okay, this is kind of what will ultimately tell you whether you're doing this right or not. So if you look at this inner term, remember you're foiling, that would be 2t. If you look at the outer terms, 3t times 1t is 3t. What you want is these two things to add up to negative 7t. So is that possible? No, that's not possible. So we know that we can't make that work, but we could try to just change the 2 and 1. So instead of 2 and 1, let's go 1 and 2, and let's see if that'll happen. Okay, this is just kind of a trial and error approach. So let's see, we're going to go 1 here, and we're going to go 2 here this time. So if we do that, that will be 1t. The outer terms are going to be 6t. What are we wanting to do? The clincher is we want that to be negative 7t. So notice you can make that happen if both of those are negative. So your factoring would go like this then. All right. So if we go back over on the problem now, let's just write down that we have the limit as t approaches 2 and the factors are 3t minus 1 times t minus 2. Okay, and then the bottom we're going to leave as t minus 2. So there's another little algebra thing I want to show you here. Okay, so if you look at these two things, these things are not the same. So you can't just cancel them. But what you can do is you can do this. All right, for instance, if I wanted to change, and it doesn't matter which one you change around, thing you need to understand is if you subtract two numbers, and then subtract them in a different order, they're always off by a negative. So these things right here, really, that really is negative 1. That's the value of t minus 2 over 2 minus t, is it's negative 1. Okay, just like if you did 5 minus 3 over 3 minus 5, you would get 2 over negative 2, therefore you would get negative 1, see? So you want to think about that a little bit. So the way I like to show students how to do this is just choose the one you want to turn around. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to do this. I'm going to do this over the side. Let's take the 2 minus t, and if we change that around, we have actually changed the problem. But since they're off by a negative, you put a negative in front. And you got to convince yourself this is right. Notice that if you distribute, you'd have a negative t, which we have. A negative negative 2 would be a positive 2. So back in my problem, what I'm going to do is I've got the limit, t goes 2. Notice how I keep writing the limit. That way I don't forget about it. So I have 3t minus 1. I'm going to leave the t minus 2 alone. And I'm going to turn the 1 in the bottom. It's really negative 1 times t minus 2. Okay, these things are mathematically equivalent. 2 minus t is the same as that. Now what happens is, now you can cancel that out. And now you can evaluate your limit. Okay, so what we're left with is the limit as t approaches 2 of 3t minus 1 over negative 1. Now you can plug it in and calculate. So if you do this, you would have 3 times 2 minus 1 over negative 1. So that's 6 minus 1, that's 5 over negative 1. Therefore, the answer to this problem is negative 5. Okay, so that's it. That's the algebra process. Now, that thing will show up every now and then where the factors are backwards in the order that they're subtracted. So that's how you handle that. Okay? All right, so let's verify this on the graphing calculator like we've been doing. So I'm going to graph the original problem. So I've got 3x to the second, and then minus 7x, and then plus 2. That's got to be enclosed in parentheses, and then divide by 2 minus x. Okay, so that's what we're ultimately going to graph is that. If we do this in a standard window, you'll see a line, just like on the last problem. Okay, so this time what I'm going to do is what was left over after the cancellation was this, and that's a line. That right there is a line. Let's just do this. Let's just go second table and do the table of values. Okay, I'll just do the graph of this one like this. So let's just get a couple of points. We have 0, 1 is a point. We have 1, negative 2 is a point. Negative 1, 4 is a point. And then just connect that into a straight line like we've been doing. And then we're going to have that hole in the graph is what the deal is, see. Okay, all right, so we have it. All right, now we have an error at 2. So when you go to x equals 2, you want to just put a bubble right there. So you have that bubble in the graph, see. Okay, and if you look at this, well, this value right here, that y value is negative 5. So the left-hand limit is going to negative 5, so is the right-hand limit. So it's the same idea. That's how 0 over 0 limits tend to work. Is you tend to have a bubble, and after you factor, you cancel that piece out, and then you're able to reevaluate the limit. So that's how that goes, okay? And again, same idea. We're doing the limit as x approaches 2. So notice if I trace at a value close to 2, if I trace it 2, I get nothing. You're undefined. But if I trace it 2.1, I get something that's pretty close to negative 5, which we got for our answer. And again, if I close in on it, closer and closer and closer, what am I doing? That limit is at 2. Okay, so if I trace at 2, so if I do 2.001, like that, well, I get a number that's close to 5. So remember, it's the limit, the value of the limit is what y is nearing or what it's getting close to as x gets close to 2 in this case, right? Okay, so let's see if you kind of got this under control. I think I'm going to have you do the next three problems. This is a good place to pause the video. You can kind of look over what I did, get things written down, make notes to yourself, and then I'm going to go ahead and pause the video. And when you're done, resume and see if you did these problems correctly. Okay? I do want you to do the graphing as well with your graphing calculator. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and put these up and you can check your answers and see if you did these correctly. So, first one, you should have got 4. So, when you follow through on this, you have 0 over 0 when you put that in. Factor the numerator, you would have x minus 3x plus 1. And then that will cancel that. This whole thing's 1, so now you do the limit of x plus 1. X goes to 3, 3 plus 1 is 4. Graphing calculator, you have this. And see what really happens on this, by the way, is really your leftover, you can just graph y equals x plus 1. So that is your y-intercept. Your slope is 1 over 1. So I just did y-intercept up 1 over 1. That's what I did. Okay, I didn't use my graphing calculator. And the key thing is you have a bubble. If x equals 3, you're undefined. You can look at the original problem. You're undefined when x is 3. You have a 0 denominator. So you have a bubble there. Okay, and that's the idea. And notice that if you do the left-hand limit, you're going to approach 4. If you do the right-hand limit, as x closes in on the 3, you're going to reach a y value of 4. So that's it. That's kind of a standard 0 over 0 example. Okay? All right, pause if you need to look at that or anything. Otherwise, I'm going to move to the next page. So problem 2, you should have gotten negative 8. The graph is a line with a bubble. This one had a couple of things, couple of features. When you plug in the 4, you wanted to make sure that you see that you get 0 over 0. When you get 0 over 0, that means you are going to get a numeric answer for the limit. So we do algebra. I factored the numerator, x 4 plus x, 4 minus x. I didn't turn it around. I just left it in that order. And then I left the x minus 4 away. Now this right here, one thing you can do on this immediately if you want to, it's okay to do it this way. When you see this situation, that thing right there, see 4 minus x over x minus 4, that's just negative 1. That's what that's going to be. And then see what I did is I just canceled it and then I added that extra negative in there. All right, that's what I elected to do, is to kind of do it that way. So what I essentially did was I turned the 4 minus x to x minus 4, so I got a negative in front. So the key thing is, what I did is 4 minus x is negative x minus 4. Or you can just cross it out and replace it with a negative 1 if you want to, okay? So you ended up with the limit x goes to 4 of negative 4 minus x. Now plug in, you get negative 8. Now you may not have done it exactly the same way I did, but if you may have done something that's still correct. Sorry, I'm putting myself to sleep. Okay, so this is the way the graph looks. And I just did this one on the graphing calculator. And I put the original in. So I get this graph. And what happens is you have a bubble here. So if x is 4, you're undefined at x equals 4. And if you follow that line, that just takes you down to negative 8. So you can tell that as you close in on x is 4, the y value closes in on negative 8. So that's how that goes. Okay? All right, got the factoring issue on that, and what you got to work with and how to change those factors backwards. God, I'm tired. All right, need to go to bed. All right, so let's see. Move on to this one. I put careful on there. The thing on this is, if you plug the negative 2 in, which you really should start that way, you don't have to if you see what I'd like you to see, but you're undefined. So that doesn't mean that the limit doesn't exist. Now, it's not 0 over 0 either. So what you have on this is you have a vertical asymptote at x equals negative 2. Remember, the vertical asymptote occurs where the denominator is undefined. This denominator gives you 0 and makes the expression undefined at x equals negative 2. Anytime I ask for a limit at a vertical asymptote, we went over earlier, use test points. So what I did is, since this is a right-hand limit, I used a number a little bigger than negative 2, like negative 1.9, and I plugged it into my expression. So that's negative 1.9 minus 2, negative 1.9 plus 2, you got a negative over positive, which is a negative. Therefore, the answer is negative infinity. Now, if you didn't get that, the graphing calculator would kind of bail you out, because this is what you get on the graphing calculator over here. And you have a vertical asymptote at x equals negative 2. And then what happens, as you can tell, as you go from the right of negative 2, right-hand limit, you can just tell that you're going down to negative infinity. So that's the idea. Okay, so pause and think about that a little bit if you need to. Those are, be careful when you're asked to do a limit around a vertical asymptote. Anytime you do a limit around a vertical asymptote, the answer is going to be the right or left-hand limit's either going to go to negative infinity or infinity. That's a guarantee if you're asked for a limit at a vertical asymptote. Okay? All right. Okay, so I'm going to move on to the next thing. We'll kind of look at the idea of kind of when you have to use a conjugate. So I'm going to do a couple of examples on these then. So first of all, what you want to know is the conjugate, I'll see if you remember this, the conjugate just means you change this sign, and it's two terms. This is called a binomial, and when you have two terms, what you do is just change the sign. So that's x minus a. In this case, this one would be x plus a. So that's called the conjugate. This will dig into your algebra background a little bit, and I'll show you what you got to do on this. So to start this one, we want to start just by plugging in 9n for x. So we would have square root of 9 minus 3 over 9 minus 9. So that would be 3 minus 3 over 0. That's 0 over 0. So the limit exists, okay? We know that that limit's going to exist. This is the indeterminate form. So you have to do algebra. So there's no factoring like on the last problems. So what you have to do is you have to deal with a conjugate. And this will show up from time to time. I'll show you kind of how we're going to do this then. Okay. So I'm just going to write down the problem. Now what we want to do is we really want this denominator to cancel out. We always want that denominator to cancel out. Okay? And that's really what we did on the previous problems too, is we factored and then we saw something in the denominator cancel out. So what you do here is you're not going to multiply by x plus 9, because that won't do you any good. If you tried it, you would fail. You wouldn't get anywhere. So we're going to multiply by the conjugate of the numerator, square root of x plus 3. This is actually what we call rationalizing the numerator. I'm sure you've learned how to rationalize denominators. Rationalizing a numerator comes in very handy in calculus. All right, so I'm going to do a little bit of algebra over the side. This is a little algebra review. So I want to show you kind of what we do over here. So we're going to FOIL this. And you can just kind of watch this and write it down if you need to. So the first term is square root of x squared. X times x is x squared. The outside term is a positive 3 times radical x. You can't multiply 3 and x because the 3 is not under a radical and the x is. The inside term is negative 3 times radical x, and then the last term, negative 3 times 3 is negative 9. So what happens is that cancels out and you're left with square root of x squared minus 9. Well, so what's the square root of something squared? Itself, so that's x minus 9. Okay, so what we end up getting then is this will be the same as the limit as x goes to 9. Now, the result of the numerator, when we FOIL'd the numerator, which I did over on the side of my paper, I got x minus 9. Now, let's write don't FOIL the denominator, because notice that's going to now cancel with that factor x minus 9. And that's what we want to happen, is we want that to cancel out. Okay, so what's going to happen is this thing is 1, so that you just remove the 1. So you end up with the limit as x approaches 9 of 1, you're left with a 1 in the numerator, over square root of x plus 3. Okay, like that. All right, so remember what happens is when you cancel that out, it's 1 over 1. Now you plug in and you're ready to get the answer. So plug in the 9, so you would get 1 over square root of 9 plus 3. That's 1 over 3 plus 3. So the answer to that limit is 1 over 6. Okay, so that's how that goes, right? Calculus has lots of algebra in it, and you have to, a lot of the things you learned in pre-calc or college algebra and trigonometry is going to be in this class. It'll show up. Okay, so I want to close off like we typically like to do is just let's look at this on the graphing calculator. So I would put this in like this. The numerator, you're going to put parentheses, square root of x, minus 3, like that, divided by parentheses for the denominator, x minus 9. So that's how that thing needs to get typed in. And let's kind of see what this looks like now. Okay, so let's do a graph. Uh-oh. What did I do wrong here? If it ever does that, do the go-to, and sometimes that'll tell you, well, tangent, how the hell did that get in there? I don't remember doing that. Okay, so anyway, let's fix that. Let's graph it. Kind of hard to see what we got going on there, but I may need to change my window. So that looks like that's exactly what the problem we're doing. I'm going to change my window. So what I'm going to do is, since we're doing the limit as x approaches 9, let's just go like 0 maybe to, 15 by a scale of 1. And it looks like we probably just need to go even like 0 to 2 or something like that. So I'm going to use this as my viewing window. Okay. So we're going to use that as the viewing window. That's how I put that in the calculator. Now let's regraph it. Okay, so let's just kind of construct a graph on this then. I'm going to do, just kind of get a table of values. So if I go second graph and look at my table of values, well, there's the number 1 and 0.5. Okay, and what happens is this thing is like this, and then it just sort of swings down like that. Okay, that's how that goes. And that's good enough. We don't have to graph the whole entire function, okay? So that's how that gets put in then. All right, let me move that stuff out of the way there, because I don't want to block up with the algebra that I did on that. So anyway, what happens on this then is it looks like as x approaches 9, which is here, it looks like that approaches the function value of 1/6. So I want to do one more thing on my graphing calculator for you. So here's the graph. Let's trace it 9. So if I trace it x equals 9, nothing exists there. So you actually have a bubble right there at x equals 9. X equals 9, you have the bubble. Now if we picked a number close to 9, like if I traced at 9.01, that gives 0.166. That's what 1/6 is. If I closed in a little further, 9.00001, I just get this. So it looks like this, the calculator is telling us that it's that. All right. And what'll happen then is if you take our answer 1/6 and divide that out, then you get the same thing. So that's how you would verify that that's a correct answer on that problem. Okay, so again, what I did is kind of summarize. It's 0 over 0 by the arithmetic, and then we multiplied by the conjugate of the numerator because we wanted to get rid of the x minus 9. We leave the x minus 9 alone. That's what's causing this function to be undefined at the beginning, see? So we want that to stay the way it is. Okay, part in this problem is the algebra. A lot of times students have to brush up on how you FOIL when you have radicals. Graphing calculator is always the same. As long as you can put stuff in the calculator correctly, trace out near the limit, you can easily verify the answers that you get algebraically. Okay, so I'm going to go to the next problem. We're not going to do this graphically because we really can't, because it's got a constant a in it. So what's going to happen on this one is step one, what I'm going to go ahead and do is let's go ahead and just plug in the a. So where you see an x, replace these x's with a. So you'd have a squared minus a squared over the square root of a squared minus the square root of a. Okay? No. That's not squared. That's just square root of a like that. Okay, so again, I'm just replacing x with a to get this, and then that would be a squared. Okay, so I think you can see on that, that would be 0 over 0. So that's going to tell us, because it's 0, 0, therefore, the limit exists, so we need to do this algebraically. And this one, graph, you can't graph it, so it ain't going to do you any good. Okay, so now this is when we get into the conjugate. Okay, so we have the limit as x approaches a. Notice this factors, so it's not a bad idea to just go ahead and factor that. So that's a difference of two squares. So that is x plus a times x minus a. Then we have the square root of x minus the square root of a. Now what we're going to do is we're going to multiply by the conjugate of the denominator. And that will get rid of the radicals. So just like on the last one, we multiplied by the conjugate of the thing that had radicals. So that we're going to multiply by square root of x plus square root of a. Numerator, square root of x plus square root of a. That's the idea. Now remember, what we're ultimately hoping will happen is that this thing right here goes away. That's what is causing the zero denominator. So we're hoping we can get that somehow to go away. Okay. So here's what we're going to do. I'm going to leave the numerator exactly as it is. I don't need to multiply this out because I'm hoping the factors cancel. So don't multiply it out. You're just totally wasting your time. Just write this the way it is. Leave the numerator in a factored form. Don't touch it. Now the denominator, I'm going to do the algebra at the side and just kind of use this again as an opportunity to review how you FOIL radicals, binomials that have radicals in it. Okay, and the reason this works is because something cancels out. So as you kind of review this, you'll begin to see why this works. So the first term is square root of x squared. The outside term is square root of x times square root of a. Now since they're both under a radical, you can write that as square root of xa. Okay. The middle term is exactly the same thing. They're both under a radical, but it's a negative, so it's square root of, you can write it ax or xa, but they're both the same anyway. And then the last term is a negative times a positive, or a negative, square root of a squared. Okay, so notice what happens. What do you see happening? That cancels. That's a good thing. What is this? That's x. What is this? Minus a. So that's the result of that denominator. So we just multiplied that out and we got this. All right, and that, remember, what we're trying to do is get that denominator to cancel out. So what happens is that is 1. This part that I'm highlighting is really just a fancy way of writing the number 1. So just get rid of it. Okay, and now let's write what we're left with. And it's a good idea to write what you're left with. You know, you're trying to make a presentation. I like you to try in my videos to help you develop good habits of how you write steps. Although my work gets sloppy sometimes, I'll give you that. So we have x plus a, square root of x plus square root of a. Now we're ready to simply, everywhere you see an x, replace it with a. So what we'll have is a plus a times square root of a plus square root of a. Now there's a little algebra going on this. A plus a, that's like terms. That's 1 plus 1, that's 2a. Okay, you've been doing that for a long time. That's just collecting like terms. If you have square root of a plus square root of a, it's the same principle. These are like terms, so that is 2 radical a. So you end up with 2a times 2 radical a. And then the best way to write the final answer is 2 times 2 is 4. And you have an a, and then you have a square root of a. All right, so that would be the answer that you'd get on that problem. That's a good problem, too. That's got, you know, it's just a generic problem where a represents any number. You would find that if a was any number, like if a was 9, the answer to this limit would be 4 times 9 times the square root of 9, and so forth. Okay? That's how that goes. So I think sometimes these problems with conjugates and radicals, students got to do a little algebra brushing up on. Okay? All right. So what I would like you to do here is, pause here and study this a little bit if you need to. Otherwise, just pause the video and move down to the next two problems. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and pause. And when you're done, you can review your work and see if you got what I got. Okay, I don't know if you guys are going to catch this or not. But I'm going to go ahead and just resume the video and show you something on this. This thing, if you plug in, you don't get 0, 0. I made a mistake on this. This should be 16. So what I want you to do is change this problem to the limit as x goes to 4 of x squared minus 16. And let's see, let's do it that way then. Yeah, okay, that's what I'm looking for. Now notice if you plug this in, you'd have 4 squared minus 16 over square root of 4 minus 2, so that's 16 minus 16 over 2 minus 2 is a 0 over 0. Now the answer to this problem would be does not exist. And you could do that on the graphing calculator. It's just not going to exist. It's not 0 over 0. You get something undefined. If you look at that on your graphing calculator, you're going to have that issue. Now, it may go to infinity or something. I want to, just while I'm at this, I want to kind of show you what will happen here. Because you'll probably have an asymptote on this. So you'll go x to the second minus 4. And then divide by parentheses square root of x minus 2. So this will have a vertical asymptote. The vertical asymptote on this is actually going to occur at 4. Let me get back to a standard window. Zoom 6. Let me zoom out on that. And it's kind of hard to see, but you do have a break in the graph like that. So if I did a window, a little hard to tell on the standard window here. But notice 1, 2, 3, 4, you actually have an asymptote there. If I made my y's expand a little bit here, oh, what's happened? I think my calculator is confused. I'm confusing my calculator, so... All right, okay, tell you what, I'll show you in a minute. I'm going to have to close this and reboot this. Go ahead and do this problem from here, okay? Then, if you already did problem number 2, you can, just pause the video and then come back and we can check the answer to both of these. Sorry about that, I just wrote the problem down wrong, okay? Okay, so I'm going to leave this up here a minute. I'll you can check over the work on this. These problems right here are pretty challenging. I think number 2 in particular sometimes has some algebra issues that students make. So you should have got 32 on the first one after we changed that problem. In the second one, you should get 1/2. All right, so I'm mostly going to kind of go through the algebra and kind of the key step on this is the FOIL. So what I did on this one is I did the factoring of x squared minus 16 is x plus 4x minus 4. Okay, then I multiplied by the conjugate of x squared of x minus 2. So you should multiply by this. Okay, you're trying to make that radical go away. So really the key thing is you're going to check your foiling. The numerator, don't foil it, and multiply, just leave it alone. Leave those three factors alone. The FOIL goes square root of x squared plus 2 root x minus 2 root x minus 4. Just make sure you're real careful about that. The inner and outer cancel. Square root of x squared is x. And you end up with x minus 4, which crosses that factor out. So ultimately what you end up with is this. So now you do the limit of that. Now you plug in and you can see how I did the arithmetic. So it's 4 plus 4 in one parenthesis, square root of 4 plus 2 in the other, so it's 8 times 4, so it's 32. Okay, so that's how that goes. The key thing is the FOIL step, are you getting that right? Okay, all right. That when I originally wrote this problem as x squared minus 4, this is what the graph of the original problem looks like. and you don't need to write this down or make a note of this, but this thing actually, the original problem actually had a vertical asymptote at x equals 4. And what happens is this was a two-sided limit, so this side goes to infinity, this side goes to negative infinity. So technically the original problem does not exist. Okay. So anyway, I wanted you to do the problem change because that's what I'm wanting you to learn how to do. Okay, the next one you should have got a half. The key on this is you get 0/0 form. Not going to really go through that part too much. And that's not the issue with most students. So what I ended up doing is I want to get rid of that radical. So you want to multiply by the conjugate of that numerator. So you multiply by square root of x plus 2 plus 1 over square root of x plus 2 plus 1. Now the key on this is the FOIL. So I do this term times this, the first term. Square root of x plus 2 times itself is square root of x plus 2 squared. Okay, the outside term is positive 1 root x plus 2. Inner term is the same thing, but it's negative root x plus 2. Last term, negative 1 times 1 is negative 1. That's the foiling. That cancels out. That's the whole key. This, the square root of something squared is itself, so you get this, minus 1. Okay, and what happens ultimately is x plus 2 minus 1 is x plus 1. That'll cancel this out. You're left with this. So the key component of this problem is if you do your algebra correct, you end up with that expression. Then you can go plug that negative 1 in. Okay, so you ended up getting 1 over 2. You can see how I did the arithmetic. Okay, all right, that's the idea. Okay, I think that last one I put on the graphing calculator to check. I can't remember. If you put this in your graphing calculator, I mean, you got to do your window kind of like, maybe we could do like something like negative 2 to 2. You don't need to put this in the calculator. I just want to show you. And then maybe negative 1 to 1. If I do the window like this, you'll see the graph on number 2 a lot better. And what happens is we're doing the limit as x approaches negative 1. And see, you can almost see that bubble there because I've got this kind of zoomed in. There's a bubble there. And this is 1, so it's approaching a half. So if I traced at a value very close to negative 1, like negative 1.001, well, you get something that's close to a half, say. So that's it. See, all these problems, can't stress enough, verifiable with technology. Every single one of them. So when you're doing your homework and stuff, you know, you can always, don't do your homework just by putting them in your graphing calculator. You won't learn anything, but it's a good way to verify, okay? All right, so let's see. I'm going to move on to the next page. One more thing we're going to do is we're going to do what we call complex fractions, and then we're going to do what we call piecewise functions. So I'm going to just do one example of a complex fraction, let you do one similar, and then we'll wrap up with piecewise functions. All right, so let's see. You want to always start these the same way. You just want to plug the number in and see what happens. Okay, don't overlook this. So we're going to plug in where we see an x, put in a 1. Now let's see if we don't get a 0/0 form limit. So we're going to have 1 over 1 plus 1 minus a half over 1 minus 1. So this is 1 half. The numerator becomes a half minus a half over 0. So yeah, that's 0/0 form. So that means the limit will exist. Probably have that bubble situation like we've been seeing over and over again. So the idea on a complex fraction, students a lot of times I find never study complex fractions. Now let me just write this over here and kind of go through the algebra. What makes this a complex fraction is this is your main fraction bar, but you have fractions in the numerator. So it kind of have a fraction and a fraction. So I want to go over a couple of things. All right, the idea in this numerator is you want to make these denominators go away. You want those two things to go away. Well, if you want x plus 1 to go away, all you got to do is multiply by x plus 1 and it's gone. If you want to make a 2 go away, all you do is multiply by a 2 and it's gone. But when you're dealing with a fraction, you have to multiply the top and bottom of the original fraction by the same number, and otherwise you're going to change the problem. A good way to illustrate this is, like if you had the fraction 1 half. If I multiply by 4 over 4, I get 4 eighths, but that's still a half, okay? But if I did 1 half times 4 times 3, I get 4 sixths. That's no longer a half. So the thing is, you never change the value of a fraction if you multiply the numerator and denominator by the same number, excluding zero, of course. So actually what you have to do on this problem, you have to do this like this. All right, so let's just write this first step kind of down like this. I'm going to put 1 over x plus 1 minus a half. I'm just going to write the problem kind of like this to start with, inserting parentheses. So what you have to do is you have to multiply the numerator by the two things you're trying to get rid of. So you're going to multiply by 2 times x plus 1. And then you have no choice but to do the denominator by the same thing. No choice at all. Okay? So what I'm going to do on this now, the key thing is once you identify, is you're really doing a distributive property. So I'm going to do this. I'm just going to multiply this out like this. If I multiply this times this out, if I multiply those two things right there, and I'm going to bring down my limit, I'm going to get limit x goes to 1, and I'm going to have the x plus 1's canceling out. Okay, just kind of imagine the x plus 1's canceling out. So you're left with 1 times 2 or 2. Okay, just look at that little piece of the problem right there. Okay, now what I'm going to do is we're going to distribute this way. So now I'm going to look at this. I'm going to look at 1 half and this. What cancels now? The 2's cancel, so you're left with minus 1 times x plus 1. Okay, if you haven't seen that before, sometimes you got to look at that a little bit. I'm distributing. The x plus 1 cancels, therefore I'm left with 2. And then the part I highlighted in blue, the 2's cancel, so I'm left with minus 1, x plus 1. The denominator, leave it alone. X minus 1 times 2 times x plus 1. Remember, you're wanting something to cancel out before you reevaluate that limit. So what we're going to have then is the limit x goes to 1 of 2 minus x minus 1 all over x minus 1 times 2 times x plus 1. Okay, simplify the numerator. You have like terms. Okay, so you will have, did I make a mistake somewhere? I think we're okay. All right, so let's see. We have limit x goes to 1, and the numerator is going to be just 1 minus x, because 2 minus 1 is 1. That's okay. So we have an x minus 1 times 2 times x plus 1. Okay, so we've seen this a couple of times already in this lecture. What happens on this? Remember, you can learn to do this. That thing right there, 1 minus x over x minus 1, is just negative 1. So you can replace it with a negative 1 if you want to do it that way. So you would end up having then the limit as x goes to 1 of negative 1 over 2 times x plus 1. Now you're ready to plug in the value of x. X approaches 1, then you'll get the answer. So we'll end up here having negative 1 over 2 times 1 plus 1. So that's negative 1 over 4. Okay, so that is the answer to that problem's negative 1, 4. Okay, so that's the algebra. And that's, you know, you can get to where you can handle these conjugates, complex fractions, and you're making a big, that's a big victory for you, okay, in calculus, all right? So I'm going to have you pause and try to do this problem and just see what you can do. Start and verify if it's 0 over 0, and then try to do something similar to what I did on that previous problem. It's a similar problem. Okay? Okay, let's see how you did. Okay, I got negative 1 over a to the second. All right, so just kind of look over my steps. It's real simple, similar to the last one we did. You're trying to get rid of an a plus h. That's why you multiply by an a plus h. You're trying to get rid of an a. That's why you multiply by a. And you have to do the same thing the top and bottom. So the key thing is when you do a distributive property, when you multiply this by this, the a plus h's cross out. You're left with a. When you do this times this, it's the a's that cross out, so you're left with negative 1 times parentheses a plus h. And then the denominator, leave it alone. That's the key, is to get this on your paper. And that's not too bad from there. So you have a minus h, distributing the negative. And then that'll cancel out, leaving negative h over ha, a plus h. H's cancel out, leaving negative 1 over a times a plus h. Plug in the 0, in for h, it's the h that becomes 0. So it's negative 1 over a times a plus 0, negative 1 over a times a, so it's negative 1 over a squared. Okay, that's how that goes. Okay, so look over that a little bit, and made some mistakes, learn from your mistakes. Alright, so you can pause if you need to. Otherwise, we've got one more thing we're going to look at. We're going to look at some piecewise functions, which we've looked at before, and I'm going to show you kind of how to deal with piecewise functions in a way where you don't have to graph. Okay, so we're not going to graph these things, so I'm going to show you kind of how we do this. So we're doing the limit where there's a break in this piecewise function. So the first thing I'm going to do, before I do the limits, I'm going to make a table of values. You actually don't even have to do the table of values, but let's just do that so I can show you what I mean by this. So square root of x, okay? Well, we can only use x values that are greater than or equal to 0. So we start with 0, and we know that is closed because it has the equality under it. Now pick some numbers bigger than 1 that you know square roots of. So you just do square root of 0 is 0, square root of 1 is 1, square root of 4 is 2. And we're not going to graph that, we're just going to make that table of values. The second piece is y equals absolute value of x. You can only use numbers smaller than 0. You want to start at 0, but you want to make a note to yourself that it's open. It's an open bubble. And then pick some numbers smaller than 0, like negative 1 and negative 2. Do the absolute value of each of the x's you chose to get this. So you've got that then. All right, now what I'm going to show you what happens on this is, notice that we're looking at 0. So really all you want to do on this is a right-hand limit. So what you want to do is plug in to the first part. So you want to plug in to square root of x. So you get square root of 0. The reason we're doing that, a right-hand limit would mean that x is a little bigger than 0, so it means it's on that piece. So that answer to that limit is 0. Okay? This one is a left-hand limit, so you're going to be a little bit to the left of 0, which that means x is less than 0, so you're going to do the absolute value of 0. Still gives 0. Okay? And then this is the two-sided limit. So we've learned the basic theorem that if the left hand goes to 0, the right hand goes to 0, then so does the two-side. And so you could see this from this table of values. They both connect at 0. They both go together at 0. But you don't even have to do the table of values. The right-hand limit, plug into the right-hand part of the piecewise function. The left-hand, plug into the left-hand part of the piecewise function. Okay, think about that. That's all you got to do. Okay, all right, we're going to do the next problem. Okay, and we'll just do table of values on this again because I want you to understand what the piecewise function's saying. So the first one let's look at is, let's look at this. Okay, we have, let's look at y equals x plus 2. These are numbers bigger than 2. So start with 2 and go bigger. And then you use 2, even though there's not an equality bar there, you need to make a note to yourself that that's an open bubble. And it's easy, okay? 2 plus 2 is 4. 3 plus 2 is 5. 4 plus 2 is 6. So I'm just plugging in those x values. Okay, go to the second piece. Okay, so what we have is we have y equals x squared minus 2. We're using numbers smaller than 2, smaller than or equal to 2. Start with 2, closed interval. Pick a number smaller than 2, like 1 and 0. That's good enough. Plug in, you'll have 2 squared minus 2 is 2. Ooh. 1 squared minus 2 is negative 1. Negative 2. Now here's the key. We're doing the limit as x approaches 2. Look what happens at 2. All right? They go to different places. So I'm going to pretty well know that that two-sided limit's not going to exist. And the reason I'm going to know that is because these things are different values. So that's not going to exist. So what you want to do on this is, this is the right-hand limit. So do the right-hand part of the graph. Do this part. You're doing numbers bigger than 2. So plug the 2 in here. So you do 2 plus 2, you get 4. Hey, that's what the table said, see? Okay. This is the left-hand limit, so go to the left-hand part of the piecewise function. Use x squared minus 2. So you're going to do 2 squared minus 2 to get 2. Yep, I see that's what that said. And then this one does not exist because they go to different places. Okay? So the table is just kind of to help you see whether the two parts of the graph connect or not. But you actually don't even have to do that. This is how you do the problem. The right-hand limit plugs into the whatever part is on the right-hand side of that number. In this case, x greater than 2 is x plus 2. The left-hand is use the number smaller than 2. Like that. That's it. Okay, so let's go down the bottom. Let you work these two problems out, and then that'll be the end of this video. And then this video, I got to do one more section on what's called squeezing theorem. Not queasing theorem, squeezing theorem. Okay, so go ahead and do these and come back and see if you got the right. Okay, so let's see if you got what I got. Okay, the first one, you should have got the right-hand limit is 5. Left-hand limit's 1. And they're different, so the two-sided does not exist. Number 2, they're all 3. So it's just a matter of knowing which function to use. The right-hand limit, use the function 5. Okay, and the table of values on that first part would just, the y value is always 5. Okay, the left-hand limit, use this part, x squared, because you want to be to the left of 1, meaning less than 1. So you just do 1 to the second, you get 1. Okay, same thing on here, I didn't even have you do a table because you don't need to. The right-hand limit, use the x greater than 3. So just plug the 3 in for x to get 3. Use this. The left-hand limit, use this part, x squared minus 6. So just do 3 squared minus 6. You get 3. And then since both the left and right go to 3, then you can conclude that the two-sided goes to 3. So that's how you handle piecewise functions without a calculator, all right? We're kind of looking at all these situations to get ourselves really familiar with functions. All right, so that'll wrap us up. I hope this helps you get to do okay with this. This is the hardest part of the section because you get into heavy algebra. So good luck.